Let's see if anyone's at the fishery now.
Fresh fish! Freshly caught!
Wow.
Effigy's eyes! It looked at me!
What? Okay. A dozen pairs of globular eyes stare up piteously from the discarded heads of the day's catch, awash in a pungent sea of fins and innards. Okay, we're gonna sift through the fish scraps. Sounds delightful. Your hand runs up against something round and fleshy, the size of a melon. It is smooth and scaleless, and parts seem to be covered in hair. A discarded head, perhaps, but not that of a fish. Poke the head? The head shifts deeper into the barrel's slimy recesses. Pull out the head. There's somebody in there. With one hand on either side of the head, you begin to lift it out of the barrel, only to have it leap from your grasp as the head's owner springs over the lip of the barrel in an eruption of fish chunks that rain down over the market stall. What? Oh, yeah, this is that monk character. The man who leapt from the barrel stands facing you, nearly naked save for a loincloth and drizzled in fish viscera. He is covered head to toe in scars, tears and punctures, and the thorny imprints of lashings. Most are faded, like old memories. Despite that, the condition of the man's body is remarkable. The drooping skin at his flanks and elbows, the only evidence of his advanced age. His face is placid, but the rest of him appears prepared for anything. What the hell is he doing in there?
You must forgive, Zahua. I was not expecting you.
Zahua. He looks you in the eye at first, but his gaze drifts now and then, settling on strange parts of your face as though distracted by new discoveries. If he is at all flustered, he gives no indication. What were you doing in that barrel? He scratches behind his ear, dismayed.
Resting my eyes, I thought. Waiting for the Malkachor to bring me insight.
He shakes his head.
It would seem I dozed. Good thing my master was not alive to see it.
Zahua blinks, leaning in to get a better look at you. His enlarged pupils seem to crowd out his pale irises.
Are you real?
Is this real life? Well, I can say yes. I can lie and say no. I can say lie and mean yes, which means that I think I'm not real. I could just tell him no. Now that you ask, I'm not so sure. I'm gonna lie and say no.
A vision of the Malkachor, then. I was expecting something more unusual. A flaming bird, perhaps, or a talking gemstone.
Malkachoa?
A small white mushroom. I have heard it called snowcap in these lands.
Oh.
It can reveal the true nature of many things.
I still don't understand why you were in that barrel.
I was freeing myself from vanity.
Adair says, did he say sanity or vanity?
Consider, how can one be vain who is bathed in the smell of dead fish?
There was a proud glint in his eyes. Hard to argue with that.
I had the idea when I passed this way earlier. I am pleased with the results so far.
He smiles at a woman whose head is swiveled towards him as she passes by, a look of revulsion on her face. Distracted, his toe catches on a stone and she nearly falls on her face. Or her toe, is that what I said? He claps his hands together.
Yes, quite pleased.
Do you often smear yourself with fish?
Gods, no. What a way to travel the world. The usual way is to smear yourself with the ashes of the dead.
Okay.
But they do not burn their dead here, so I have to make do with what the land provides.
He sniffs the air.
The cold seems to conquer the smell. Even now, the scent hides itself. Disappointing.
You don't seem like you're from around here.
I was visiting a monastery, not far from here. I found it empty, but I met a messenger as I left. He carried a call for aid. Seeing that he would find no monks at the monastery, I chose to go in their place. Zahua is no longer young, but in combat he is still the greatest of the Takan people. It seemed only right that he should go.
Those scars are from battle? He glances down at his body.
From battle, yes. I left them upon my enemies.
He points at various patches of crisscrossing scars.
These were struck against fear. These against pleasure. These against hatred. Those down there against greed and doubt.
Down there?
And these.
He points to his face.
These were for vanity.
You made those scars?
I cannot take credit for all of them, but I did most of the good ones.
His mouth perks.
I put them there in battle to remind myself what is real and what is not. Our worst enemies are inventions of the mind, pleasure, fear. When we see them for what they are, we become unstoppable.
And you have achieved this?
I feel I have been close, but never for more than an instant. In the moment when the pain is sharpest, the world becomes clear. In that moment, I am a match for anyone.
He gives a slow, assured nod. Your wounds must have caused you to suffer greatly.
Of course. I am fortunate to have suffered so much. If I did not suffer, I would not aspire to free myself from it. I would wander from one unfulfilling goal to the next. More wealth, a better station. My soul would wither. But to search for a place beyond suffering's reach is to nurture the soul, to harden it against the elements.
He clenches his fists in illustration.
Suffering is the greatest gift the gods have given us, their most beautiful, perfect creation. It is the hand that turns the wheel.
His eyes gleam as though looking upon an old and beloved friend. Stalwart hired me as well.
I would not say I am hired. I seek no wage, and I promise no result. I have chosen a path, and my spoils come from walking it.
An uneasy frown settles on his face, almost a wince. Oh, I see it.
And this fortress, this Durgan's battery, its people are gone. Zahua would know why.
If you seek the White Forge as well, I could use the help of an experienced warrior. Zawa's face tilts upward, his eyes fixing on the sky. He remains motionless, entranced. At length he blinks as if awakening and looks back at you. He shrugs cheerily.
If one wishes to swim, it is no time to argue with the current. We are here, together, in this moment, because a perfect force has willed it. Who is Zahua to argue?
He looks you squarely in the eyes, and for once they do not drift.
I will walk with you so long as the gods wish it so.
I'm not going to trade him in yet. Let's be on our way. Joined and left the party. I'm still in fast mode. In the fishery, I guess. Fishery guard and workers.
We should check the barrels for more crazy monks.
Just as we're doing so. Just a few minutes more and the fishery would have burned too.
Back to work, everyone. No time for dallying.
Half my shift was on the militia. We lost a lot of people. Grynde tallied the dead. Gonna have us work extra shifts to make Quora. Another attack like that and we won't have enough hands to feed the village. This tattered net appears to have been set aside for mending. What? Sorry, my ears are still ringing. The dead eyes of speckleback, ironwood pike, and frost diver fish gaze up at you. Yeah, no monks. I wasn't expecting anyone to come by the fishery for a while. Guess that's the proper way to go about it, really. Carry on like it's business as usual. Can I get you anything? Let me see what you have, of course. Nothing. Not much of anything, really. Plenty of camping supplies around here. These roasting fish provide much of the pungent odor permeating the fishery. I guess we'll talk to this guy.
A fine thing you reached us when you did. It would have burned the fishery next, mark my words.
He wraps your hand in a sturdy handshake.
And the last thing this lot needs is another excuse to knock off early.
He raises his voice at this last remark and glowers around the room. The other fisher folk look studiously away and focus on mending nets, gutting fish, and sorting the day's catch. Ayla says, I can't imagine why they'd be in any hurry. He looks as if he's trying not to breathe.
Anyway, excuse the mess. If there's something you need, the clerk can get you sorted.
He raises a graying eyebrow at a man sorting various stocks and supplies near the back of the room.
Just watch your step if you've a mind to look around. The floors are slick and none too pleasant to fall on.
Got some questions about the fishery.
Been running it 4 decades now. Reckon I can tell you what you want to know.
Seems like a big operation.
It may stink of fish guts, but there's no place more critical to Stalworth's survival.
He nods, a blush of pride rising above his beard.
Herds come and go, so there's seasons when our catch sustains the village.
He glances around the fishery, bustling with activity and warm with the heat of the cook fire.
But try telling these folk as much. We go home each day covered to the elbows in fish oil and entrails, reeking of our work.
His eyes soften with the gaze of a stern but loving father. Aeloth forces a smile. Charming.
Stalwart's shrinking. But it would disappear if we lost the fishers. I drive them hard, but I can't afford to do otherwise.
What do you do here?
Just about everything. I track the day's catches and see that our nets and hooks are in working order.
He crosses his arms over his broad chest, throwing his shoulders back.
My family's been in charge of the fishery since the early days of Stalwart. I know the best spots to find frost diver and iron tooth pike. And I make sure we don't overfish the speckleback.
Okay, that's all I wanted to know, thanks.
Need anything else?
Nope. Yeah, we're done in here. Check out this Temple of Ondra. Perhaps if I adjust this like so. I'll find it, without your help. Not giving up, you hear me? Charlatans, I'll... Who's this? Okrun? And Ista?
I'm ready.
Oh, it's working! Yes! I can't believe it! It's really... Oh...
The dwarven woman looks at you, a disappointed expression on her face. In her hands is a large rectangular box covered in strange dials and symbols. I get the reaction a lot. What's working?
My ore locating divination tool. Well, that's what it will be. I have to calibrate it. Right now it seems to think you're a copper deposit.
I know I turned fast mode off.
My animancer contacts did suggest that a particular strong soul essence might interfere. I'm more interested in minerals, in any case.
Huh. How does that device work?
It's actually quite sophisticated, if you'll forgive me a little professional pride. A mix of alchemical processes and scrying enchantments, and some very expensive crystals. I'm trying to recreate the instruments that first led the Pargrim dwarves to this mountain. This is my latest prototype.
She holds up the metallic box.
Centuries ago, dwarves carrying tools just like this one followed their readings to what is now the battery. If I can recreate their work, then I may be able to find ore deposits elsewhere. I was hoping to test it, but my arrival was delayed by word of the ogre attack. I haven't been able to find anyone to venture up the mountain since.
There's a scientist class? Well, I guess it's a background. I could go up the mountain for you.
Really? That'd be wonderful. I just have to adjust the device, you see.
Her hands move swiftly over the box, adjusting knobs and dials.
It should point you toward metal deposits. We already know the battery rests on some rich veins, but I was hoping to get a reading of the surrounding mountainside. If you can follow the readings to ore and bring back a sample, I can use it to refine the device. Thanks ever so much for this!
She hands you the box. Huh. A woman named Ista is trying to recreate the alchemical instruments by which the battery dwarves first located the site upon which they erected their fortress. She has a prototype she wants tested if someone will brave the wilds to do so. Ista is certain that her device works similarly to those used by the dwarves of Durgan's battery to divine the location of valuable metals. She has asked me to test the device on the mountainside surrounding the battery. Cool.
I hope you've had some luck, and do take care with that device. It has a few rather delicate components.
No luck yet. I have to leave first. Okrun? A dwarf paces with his head down and arms crossed, only stopping to hurl glances at the building behind him. His face is smeared dark with grime, and soot falls from his beard as he mumbles to himself. I guess these two have nothing to do with one another. I thought they were. Work my hands into bloody stumps in this place. And for what? He kicks at a mound of dirty snow. Start with nothing, leave with less. He extends his arms out. The attack of the ogres has hurt everyone. Hurt. The dwarf hunches his shoulders as if saddled with weight. He looks around to the passing villagers. Don't mistake me for one of them. I carry more on my back than tinder and pelts. Well, good riddance. Should have never settled here in the first place. Some things you mean to leave behind. Come to find out, you packed them anyway. But I'm not leaving until I recover what's mine. They can't deny me again. Not after this. Okrun gestures at the burnt-out buildings. Those sweet-tongued priests took my heirlooms. Bury the memory of my past, they said. Now I don't even have that. I take it you gave something of yours to one of Ondra's gift-bearers? Okrun takes his gaze away from the ground and gives you a sideways glance. You're quick. Wish I had those wits when they spoke of peace and redemption in the eyes of the goddess. Those priests, Ondra's dogs, said the goddess would forgive, that some things were best left to be forgotten. He nods towards the nearby temple. Their leader, Lafta, I believed her words. Another one of them, a gift-bearer, took my medallion. He closes his stocky hand into a fist. And now they won't tell me where it is. Well, I've got a lot of options here. Why won't they tell you? Because they think they know better, that's why. Said it was the only way I'd forget. What did you want to forget about your past? That was a different life. Better days. Until... Okrun closes his eyes and shakes his head. Motes of soot fall onto his hunched shoulders. It's my burden to bear, not yours. I thought to cast it away, but the memories I lost were all the wrong ones. What else did you give the priests? The dwarf casts a measuring look at you. He quickly turns his head away and nods. You'd understand its value. My armor, a set finer than I've ever seen. But worthless to an old dwarf. I'd have traded it for the medallion, but fool that I was, I gave them both. They'll respond better to tact than tirades. The dwarf grunts. Sharp metal always used to win me arguments, but I see your point. I'd be surprised if they return it willingly. They believe it's a sacred duty to cast the offsprings to the goddess in some place where they'll be forgotten. Better to find where they dropped them, I think. Tell me about this medallion you want to recover. It belonged to my sister. It was just a pretty trinket to her. To me? The dwarf casts his gaze down. She was the last of my family. At least it still acted like family to me. What's Lafta's role in all this? She leads that group of crows that took over the temple as folks started to leave, came to unburden those that sought to forget their misery here, they say. I don't expect luck to grace me now, but if you find anything, I'll be here. Count on it. He gives you a vigorous nod. Speak with Lafta. Okrun has lost everything during the attacks against Stalwart. Before leaving the village behind, the dwarf wants to recover a medallion he gave to Lafta, priestess of the Temple of Ondra, to be cast away in secret, a decision he now regrets. He gave his medallion to the priestess in the Temple of Ondra. She should know where the gift-bearers dropped their offerings to the Lady of Lament. He confirmed that taking offerings once they are given to Ondra isn't a common practice. He found little cooperation from Ondra's followers. His sister's medallion wasn't all that the priest took to be cast away and forgotten. He also gave them his old armor, though he seems interested in recovering only the medallion.
I understand.
Temple of Ondra. Pearls. Ooh. Carvings dedicated to Ondra adorn every inch of this large wooden chest. Its lid appears firmly secured even with no latch or locking mechanism in sight. We're not going to try to open it because these guys are right here. Let's inspect it. Perception 15. The chest seems old, its wood cracked and bleached by the passage of time, but the edges of the lid are less faded. It appears to have been handled recently and often. Before you can take a closer look, an acolyte snaps around to face you. Don't touch that! His voice cracks like a whip. The other acolytes look at him as if to urge some composure. He frowns. I mean to say that's sacred to Ondra. Please, leave it alone. Dot dot dot. Quirksel? Kicksettle? There's a Lafta person. Different coins. A young man dressed in sturdy leathers glares at you. The creases in his face, tanned despite the scarce sunlight of the region, suffer a slight twitch as you approach him. I've got nothing for you. Speak with Lafta if you must. He turns away, his nose wrinkled. Leave me be. Okay. Veins course under this woman's pale skin, like icy fissures, yet when she speaks, her voice flows warm and soothing. Ondra welcomes you into her embrace. Her features soften into a look of practiced compassion. We're here to ease the pain of your past, ready to take your burdens. With a thin smile, she nods. If you let the goddess help, with your hardships, of course. Tell me about Ondra. Ondra's the goddess of redemption. Deep like an ocean and gentle as a mother. She's here to relieve her children of their darkest burdens. We came here to aid the villagers, to heal the wounds of the past that fester in their souls. I thought Ondra was the goddess of loss and mourning, not redemption. That's a... The priest crosses her arms and shifts her weight. Common notion. Others may believe so, but the goddess's mysteries are profound. Her true power lies in redeeming your loss and regret. Was there something else you wanted to talk about? I want to know about the gift bearers. Gift bearers do Andra's most valued work. They carry the material burdens of unfortunate souls into her embrace so that the goddess may help them forget. I want to ask you about Okrun's heirloom. The dwarf already asked. We gave him the counsel he needed. Slight irritation sharpens her tone. She seems to catch herself, modulating her voice back to a pleasant timbre. And naturally, we'll do what we can for you, too. Ask what you will. Okrun wants his medallion back. She brings her hands together and nods. Ah, Okrun, how often we let the shadows of the past become a burden even to others. That medallion, it weighs on Okrun's mind. You're kind to help, but what he really needs is to cast away those memories. Isn't that for him to decide? He did. He understood the solace that the goddess can give to those like him. It was explained to him that many have second thoughts, that one does not withdraw something offered to a goddess. In time the memories fade, and they come to see the wisdom of their original pledge. His belongings, his past, now rest in Andra's realm, to be forgotten so that the wounds of the soul may heal. That is the will of the goddess. Let's use our lore ability. Her will flows in tides. Maybe Okrun still needs the medallion to discover how to forget. For a moment, the priestess scans the floor before her as if in search for an answer. She nods. You're well versed in the intricacies of our faith. No use in hiding anything from someone like you. There's no need to quarrel over the mysteries of a goddess's will. I'll tell you what you wish to know. Okrun's heirloom was taken by Ixtli, chosen gift-bearer among us to be cast away as an offering to Ondra. Only he knows where. She pauses and looks at you intently. You could ask him yourself, but he's on a trek through the mountains of Durgan's battery. If you run into Ixtli, tell him he has urgent duties to attend here. It's hard to believe that only the gift-bearer knows where Andra's offerings are cast away. Is it? Our goddess frees us from our earthly burdens. It's best if only one of us knows where they are taken, lest we end up suffering under their weight. Tell me about your gift-bearer. Ixtli had business near Durgan's battery. Those mountains are dangerous. Lafta seems to stare at the floor for a moment, but you notice her eyes dart to one of the acolytes, a young man of Ishimital blood. I'll never know how to say this word. If you insist on carrying out this request of Okrun's, then that's where I'd search for answers. Let me ask you about something else. No, that's it. Farewell. Lafta claimed that only Ixtli, a gift-bearer, knows the location of Okrun's medallion. Unfortunately, he's still on a journey near Durgan's battery. Alright. Failure turned out to be. Okay, I don't know if there's anything much to explore. We haven't been in the Greff's Rest or Renengild's house. Oh! As you step outside, the heavy wooden door of the temple slams shut behind you. You hear someone barring it from the other side. It sounds like the priests have engaged in an agitated conversation. You get the sense that they are discussing you, but you're also certain that the door is too thick to eavesdrop through, though there may be other places nearby where you'd stand a better chance. Can't believe this. I overheard a commotion inside the Temple of Ondra after I spoke with Lafta. Perhaps there's something else to be learned from the conversation between the priestess and her acolytes. Oh, here? Cool. I like this, guys. The wooden shutters of the temple's window close tight, muffle a set of voices coming from within the building. You can't quite make sense of the murmur, but cracking a shutter open would likely help. I like it. It's like a choose-your-own-adventure kind of stuff. A rusty iron latch holds the window shutters closed. With care, you should be able to unfasten it without being noticed. Unfasten. Oops. You carefully begin to lift the hatch from its metal hook. Halfway there, the rusted iron resists with a screech. You freeze, listening to the voices in hopes the priests didn't hear. Their conversation continues uninterrupted. Oh, can we put oil on the latch? I guess we have oil. Yeah, we picked up some oil recently, right? I think. Maybe. You grab the latch and apply just the right amount of oil, nudging the metal until its rust gives way without a sound. Carefully, you pull the window shutters open enough to let the voices flow through. You hear a man speaking, his tone agitated. You do that? Hope the mountains will do it? What if Ix... His sentence cuts as if the man were speaking to all sides of the room. Suppose she tells him instead. What then? You recognize Lafta's voice responding. Why would she? And with all those dangers near the battery? Our gift-bearer won't delay. I expect that... The man interrupts her. You always expect. Look where that's taken us. A dying village. Ogres at the walls. Ickley's not back yet, and now I have to do his pat. His voice drops and ceases, muffling what he has to say. After a moment, Lafta replies. Do you think I wanted this? That I could have known in advance? A pause ensues, its tension growing until the priestess's voice cuts it in half. We can't wait for him. We must fish out the last batch, quickly. After that, we'll decide. The man responds in a broken voice, barely audible. You only distinguish the last words in that russet wood pond. I'll go. Their exchange seems to end. Cautiously, you step away from the window of Andra's temple. Oh, this dude with the green cape. I listen to a private conversation between Lafta and her acolytes. Apparently they worry for the safety of their gift-bearer, Ixley, during his journey near Durgan's battery. The priests also spoke of something important to them that's hidden in the russet wood. Hmm. Well, that would be that way, then. Okay, now for real. We're gonna go to Rinnengild's house. But we will be entering this next episode. So I am about out of disk space. Disk space. Who's Tealdor?
Been looking everywhere.
Okay, never mind. The man is sweating despite the cold. He opens his mouth to speak, but all that comes out is a loud, hacking cough. He bends forward, bracing his hips on his thighs while he heaves and gasps. After a lengthy duration, he raises a finger, still panting. All Hefric's fault. Damn fool sent me to the other side of town, looking for you. At last he stands again. He wipes his dripping brow with the back of his hand, and then offers that hand to you in greeting. Pick your nose and shake his hand. We'll shake his hand, what the hell. Pleasure to meet you. I'm the captain of the militia around here. Really? I didn't see you during the ogre attack. See, I was, guarding the Grave's Rest. Someone had to make sure the ogres didn't burn it down like they did Katie's house. Damn shame, that. He frowns and shakes his head solemnly. These people are all cowardly. I wanted to catch you before you went running off into the wilds. See, there's a few dangerous folk you might want to be on the lookout for. Plus, if you're heading out to Longwatch Falls, I thought you might... could pick up a thermal pearl for me. He looks away and twists the toe of his boot into the snow. I'm going to find a thermal pearl for you? That's a thing. I already found it. I just need someone else to go out and get it. Saw it in the hot springs near Longwatch Falls. Would have grabbed it myself, but that's when I looked around and saw the Lugophoeth. Must have been 50 of them. He spreads his arms wide. I would have fought, but I started to wonder what the rest of Star would do without me, so I ran, for the sake of the village, of course. What's a thermal pearl, anyway? They form in the hot springs. Something to do with all the minerals in the water. Smell kind of funny, but they're full of minerals. Just have to crumble them into a pint. He grins, and you notice that his gums are bleeding. They cure scurvy. Like I said, the pearl's in one of the thermal pools near Longwatch Falls. Shouldn't be hard to spot. Tell me more about Longwatch Falls. It's east of Stalwart, got some nice views of the valley, but most folk avoid it these days. Plenty of wilder nearby, and it only takes a few inches of snow to block the pass. If you're headed out that way, I'd suggest talking to Thirsch. He might have something to help you deal with the Lugophoeth. That's all I needed to know. Stop by Thirsch's place before you leave town. His is the house next to the mines. He's a veteran hunter who knows the wilds better than anyone. You said something about dangerous folk in the wilderness. We get our share of crazies out here. Most of them aren't even from the village. He laughs at his own joke. Latest groups I've heard of were the Gleaming Society and the Sisterhood of the Slaked Skull. But Rinnengild set aside some bounty money to see that these troublemakers were taken care of. You bring me the heads of their leaders and I'll give you payment. What about this Gleaming Society? Crazy pack of radicals that wants to topple governments and kill the wealthy. Makes the War of Defiance look like a food fight. Duke Avar in the region of Red Sarah spoke declared them illegal, which is probably the only thing those two would agree on. Or would have before all that murder and mayhem in Defiance Bay. He frowns, scratching the back of his neck. Anyway, check Longwatch Falls to the east. That's where they were last seen. Who leads the Sisterhood of the Slaked Skull? That'd be Mesla. All the members of the Sisterhood worship Barath. By sending as many folk back to the wheel as they can. He shivers. They've been poking around Durgan's battery, and Whale only knows why, but you can understand why no one around here was pleased to hear about it. Passed through town recently. Didn't stay long, but they stopped at the Temple of Ondra. You might see if Lafta knows something. If you come across them, be careful. They're unpredictable. The hot springs Tealdor told me about are east of town near Longwatch Falls. That's where he saw the thermal pearl and a horde of Lugophoeth, whoever the hell they are. Tealdor recommend that I visit Thirsch, an experienced hunter, before braving Longwatch Falls. Okay, so we gotta go back there. There are rumors that the Gleaming Society has taken refuge in the White March to lay low before their next attack. Some say they can be found around Longwatch Falls east of Stalwart. They've been targeting and assassinating political figures in both the Deerwood and Red Saras. A bounty has been put on the head of their leader, Ulmar. And there's a bounty on Mesla, leader of the Sisterhood of the Slaked Skull. Have been spotted in the wilds that surround Durgan's battery.